Hi guys, Michael Malley, New Edge Sports. What you're gonna get is a video that's gonna cover one of three subjects, either a diagnosis and repair, a modification, or the installation of a particular part, okay? One of the reasons why I do make these videos is so that if you guys see me out on the field, I am there just like you guys, wanting to shoot people with the babies. Okay, so if you do have questions or tech questions, watch the video or ask me at lunch. And you can always come to the shop and bribe me with a cup of coffee, because I love coffee. So hope these help you guys out, and see you on the field. All right, so doing a bit of a boneyard build for my saw. All right, well, for the squat gun. So this was the stock piston, right? This is, it's held up pretty well in it. I don't know what the stock spring was. It was an A&K. Yeah, so this is going to go, because we're going to put in minimum 130. I'm going to have to use a 150. Balance it out with the 30,000 motor. Here I have this piston. It's full metal. It's been cut in short strokes, so I don't know what it was. Once again, boneyard. Pulled it out of something that didn't work. So, because I'm going to run 13:1 gears, I want to get as much energy out of this thing as possible. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to check the weight. So I think I'm going to use the heaviest one and go from there. So here we have the fancy scale. All right, we're going to set this guy to grams, which we already are. All right, and let's see where this one is at. 29 grams, so that's not bad. All right, now, here's a VFC piston, okay? I like this piston head better. It's clean. It hasn't been short stroked. Second tooth is gone from the factory, so it obviously wasn't modified. I think with a 130 spring, with the half metal, I should be good. 150 spring, I might get stripping here. I don't know, but let's just weigh it. Let's see, 22 grams. So, I think at 22 grams, I am going to now check the AOE and release point of both of these. And if this fits perfect, then I'll probably go with this because it's heavier. But I might take this piston head off and replace this one. All right, guys, see you soon. All right, guys, so this is, I guess, part two of one of many for this build. This is the boneyard saw that I've been working on. The previous one you guys saw, where I had to get all the duct tape off, switched out a lot of the externals from the boneyard one. Basically, it's two boneyard guns that are going to make one. So right now, these are my 13:1 gears. All right, they've been shimmed. I'm not going to bore you guys with the whole shimming process, because I've got about four videos up on shimming. And these guns are pretty much self-explanatory. So, also these clamps are awesome, because it keeps you from having to screw, and unscrew, and you can get them at Home Depot. They're hella strong. If you leave it, put it on your finger, it pretty much would almost chop your finger off. At least cut it off so bad you'd wind up whining and bitching. So, alright, so we got this guy clamped. What I look for when I shim, and how I shim this one, is no play this way, up and down. See that? No play there. The other thing I'm hoping you can see, if I get in closer, let me just look at the camera for a bit. Alright, so I get in closer, there's a gap. Alright? Where's my flashlight? I'm going to shine this flashlight in here, and you'll see that there's space between the gears. Minimal space. All right? That's also very important when it comes to shimming, that you have absolutely minimal space. You want almost zero play. Okay? A little bit of play isn't bad. Like 0.15, 0.1, 15 millimeter play, 0.15, yeah, that's fine. But if you see there, hopefully you guys can see in the video, there's a space between every one of these gears. All right, I've seen guys shim it and then have the gears waste that whole time shimming because the gears rub against each other, like they're rubbing on top of each other. So when you shim, First, think about gear on the gearbox, okay? Then, once you get this gear set, then think about this gear, not where it touches the gearbox, but where the gear touches this gear. So everything here, like I said, I'm really hoping you guys can see it. I've got a tiny, tiny space. So that when I spin it, there's no play. There's nothing. Okay? The only noise you're going to hear is from the gears rubbing together. But I have no play this way, no play that way, no play that way. And the gears are not rubbing. I've cut down my resistance with the bearings as close to actual zero, other than the fact that this gear has to come in contact and move this gear, which creates resistance. Okay? Very important. So this thing's now shimmed. This is going to be 13 to 1 gears. Now, because of the 13 to 1 gears, and this is going in the MK2, we have a very long barrel. Okay? It's going to be around, I think, a 400 millimeter, if I remember. Either way, it's a 400 millimeter barrel. So, when you get this gun stock, it comes with a solid cylinder. Okay? Downside to a solid cylinder when we're going to have a high speed build is that we're actually going to lose some volume. All right? Yeah, you sit there and you go, solid cylinder, not going to lose volume. But we actually can lose volume because the cylinder is opening and closing faster. Okay? Kind of similar approach-wise to the dwell on a paintball gun. When you increase the rate of fire in order to keep the velocity consistent and you want to keep your range, well, you need to increase the dwell. Okay? So it's the same principle. This, you're doing it mechanically. You're doing it like a clock. Okay? So all the other tech guys out there will get what I'm saying. So what I did with this was, in order to make sure I get a great seal, all right, changing out the tappet plate, I also added a delayer. 13 to 1 gear is going to feed pretty fast. I haven't upgraded the motor on the box mag yet, so in order to make sure I get good bursts while it's going, I put the delayer on here. Next, always, all the parts, they never fail me consistent time and time and time again, are the ASG Ultimate Upgrade parts. Nozzle, O-ring. Okay, this is their new updated version 2 cylinder head. All right. This pad here keeps it so quiet. It takes so much stress off the front of the gearbox. It's crazy. So if you were to put this in a version 2, 2.5 DMR build on like the A&K, which has the 2.5 version gearbox, which gives you your volume, this is going to be an awesome upgrade. So much stress from the front of the gearbox is taken away. Or if you're going to do a DSG build on like an MK18, okay? The thick pad behind this, let's see if you guys can see it. You see in there, it's got a nice thick pad. It's also slightly concave, so you get good airflow. Your air is not going to tumble, which means the air is going to get there nice, easy, squeezy. And this, there's lots of padding on here. So even if you have it radiused plus this, your gearbox is going to last a lot longer. This is a well-thought-out upgrade for a version 2 gearbox. I mean, this is just, it's awesome. So much padding. I've installed this in another gun, and it does cut down the noise by about 50%. I put it in an ASG Sportline that a customer had basically, he was running, got knocked over, fell down, almost split his gun in half. But he cracked the stock air nozzle. So I replaced it with this, cut the noise down by 50%. So I'm also pretty sure that as soon as I get the time on my own guns, I'm going to be putting one of these in my Scorpion. I think this is going to be great. It's going to really quiet up my Scorpion really nice. Okay, I'm using this piston because of the weight. All right. These gears here, originally, somebody had put it in a version 2 gearbox, so they had short-stroked it. So I checked it. It didn't need it, but just because this gear is gone, I just short-stroked it just because I wanted it to look good, because regardless, it's going to happen, and I do not need, because of the speed of these gears, anything possibly grabbing while this piston is going to be thrown forward. All right, so there's that. The spring in here, the stock spring in this was a 110. Because I'm going with 13 to 1, I'm going to be putting in a 130 spring. Hopefully I'll get the velocity because I have really good compression here and here. All right. Let me get this going. Zero. Really good compression. Okay. So this really awesome compression, plus this, the aluminum piston head for weight, lots of holes, solid O-ring, not a vented, not a hollow O-ring, solid O-ring. Hollow O-rings, the air inside needs to actually heat up. So if you have a AEG where you find that you have to take 7 or 8 shots and then you start to get good seal, there is a chance that you have either a pancake piston from a manufacturer who thought that was a good idea, which it really wasn't, or you have a cylinder with a hollow O-ring in the air. Believe it or not, inside the O-ring has to get hot and expand. That expansion is what keeps the O-ring holding its shape, which gives you the compression, which gives you the air seal when the piston flies forward. So there's that. So this is what's going in here. Right now, everything in here is good. This is all checked. Next step, I put this back together. All right, we're going to clamp this again. Now that we've already checked these gears, I can clamp it even tighter here. Right? All right. All right, good. We got great movement on the tappet plate. It's really easy. I didn't put the tappet spring in because I want to make sure I can move it really easy without any help from the tappet spring throwing it forward. Okay? May sound goofy, may sound anal, but guess what? Little things, and I learned this, and thanks to Peter, the tech at ASG, the tiniest things on this can be off. I had a Scorpion that I wouldn't chrono, and the problem was is I actually had an oddball shim, and everything else on the gun, the shimming was actually spot on. Zero play, it was perfect, but I had a shim here that was a little bit longer. So what happened was when the sector gear would come back and hit the tappet, it would grab the tappet, slow it down just a tiny bit to cause just enough drag for that. When this piston went forward, it left the tiniest gap between the air nozzle and the bucking. So I was actually losing about 70 FPS. Once we got rid of that stupid oddball shim I had, which literally was like maybe 1.1 millimeter wider than this. Once that was gone, and then we looked at the wear on the tappet plate. Well, he did it, not me, and he showed me the wear on the tappet plate. Scorpion worked flawlessly. By the way, if anybody really wants to get a gun out the box that's stupid, mad, crazy, awesome, get a Scorpion. Regardless of whatever length they come in, just get a Scorpion. It'll be awesome. So anyways, so to help compensate for the speed on this build, I'm putting in an M14 cylinder with a little bit of venting, okay? I'm hoping that will help make up for some of the volume with the heavier 130 spring as opposed to the 110. So all goes well. That should come out and get me around where I want to be with the hop-up off, hopefully around 370 feet per second. All right, good. So hope that helps you guys. I will be back after this long example. I'm going to put this back together and now on to the electronics. See you guys later. All right, soldering time. So we're doing this for the MOSFET. All right, these connectors are silver. I don't have any silver connectors, so I'm going to keep these. So let's do this.
Right. So I'm putting a thinner wire in a thicker wire. I'm going to do this. Which may seem weird, but it works for me. I hate it when these solder tubes get towards the bottom. Then they're a pain, particularly when the solder falls in. Tin it. And then this wire here. See this, but I am stuffing the wire in between so that this small wire is actually in. It's in between there, and I did it longer so that it's actually stabbed into the insulation. Yeah, I know, it's goofy. But guess what? I will have one solid connection. That's not going to go anywhere, and it's melted in there. Perfect. Then two pieces. This covers that, then that covers that. Bada bing, I'm good. So that's that wire. Now, this is the other wire that's important. We're going to do the same thing. This wire, and then I'm going to take this, see that there, that's going to go through the gearbox. I want this to be a little bit longer so I can stagger it. I like to stagger my wires too so they don't get stuck. This is the important connector. This is the connector that goes to the MOSFET. Didn't show you guys earlier when I did the first one. I will show you now. I cut this length. This wire here is stripped. Come on. Twice as long. Okay? This wire is twice as long, so when I push it in, I'm actually pushing it into the insulation. Then I solder it. So I'm basically making a solid wire. Took a lot of that flux off because of my stupid sausage fingers. Alright, so hopefully you guys were able to see that. But by doing it that way, we have a solid connection. That's not coming out at all. And because this is soldered here and now they're soldered back here, this connection, see how it bends there? It's protected by the insulation. It's not going to break. Ideal way to connect it. See you guys in a bit. Shrink a little more. Yes, dimming lights from power usage. So that's done. Alright, now these are our original connectors. These connectors are silver, which is nice, but because I don't have an electronic store close by, what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut these. I'm going to use these with this wire and this wire to go to the MOSFET. So I'll be back in a minute and I'm going to show you guys the soldering job for this, or how I do it. And once again, as always, I hope this helps you guys out. See you in a second. All right, wires are done. Everything else is in.
God, just click in. Fuck, these things are so hard.
Okay. Not like if the wire doesn't snap in. Tighten it. Putting the Z-tack together for your helmet? Yes. Try to modify them to fit Howard lights. It's probably the next most annoying thing. Alright. Cutoff lever. Stop that. Anti-reversal latch. Here we go. doing here? What are you giving me a hard time for? It if that wire went the other way, but that'll work either way regardless. Back in a minute, gotta get the MOSFET. All right. MOSFET is hooked up. Good, solid connection. To give me a hard time. Regular cut, M130 spring. All right. That seems very tight. Very, very tight, but that could be the motor. It is a high torque after all. All right. Let's see what happens. Ha ha! We have ignition. Whoa! We are good. We have ignition. And I have a... Oh no! I bent the wire. Shit. Edit that part. Alright. So now for the test. Must do this very carefully. Not too bad. Not too bad. Getting heat? No. Awesome. We are working. Alright guys, so this is the ongoing project, the saw, okay? As with most everything I get is boneyard. This one here had lots of duct tape, okay? So lots of duct tape, not fun. So you want to figure out how to get this off. Well, the easiest way I found to get this off, and also off the barrel, you can see just everywhere is just duct tape. You don't even want to look at the receiver for the saw. But to get the duct tape off, what I do, and also I'm going to show you guys on these polymer pieces that it doesn't do any damage, is goof off. Okay? This is the best stuff in the world for that. Now, here's the thing. It does get rid of adhesive, asphalt and tar, dried latex paint, blah, 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 blah. This stuff stinks. So, the next thing I have is charcoal respirator. Okay? These things stink, and I figured because it stinks so bad, why get it on my hands? Besides that, you know, if you chew your fingernails, latex gloves are golden, so you're going to want some of these gloves here because they're not going to get torn up. So that and my mask, and I will show you guys, and paper towels, show you guys how I get this stuff off. Feel free to put in a proctologist joke.
Now, I fold this up because the goof off is going to go all the way through, so I'm going to get to use more and more of this. Okay? Get off the glue. It's time consuming, but you want to know what? It's worth it. Go in a little circle. Little motions are best. That's what I have found. But I will say, do whatever works for you. Now, you can fold it. You still have some goof off here. So you don't have to add as much now. You just add a dab and just keep going. See? All nice, clean, no duct tape. A little goof up does go a long way. The lint doesn't help. This piece here. Oh, okay, well, on this side, it looks like we might be getting a little discoloration. Yeah, it looks like this. I don't know if that's glue, but if it is, oh, not good. So maybe it might be a little overkill, but truthfully, on this side, it's been weathering it, so I don't care. Yeah, a little bit of discoloration. Oh, now there's a lot. Interesting. Looks like they painted it. But you want to know what? I can live with that because I want the glue off. This is the main part too. It's not doing any damage to this because this is black. So maybe goof off is too strong for this gray piece. So there you go. I have assumed, and that's what happens when you assume. You can see right there the color. All right, but now the barrel. We have this for sure. Is not going to be an issue because it's anodized. So, there you go. The goof. Right there. Alright, so we do nicely, very nice on the black parts, very nice on the anodizing. All the duct tape residue is gone. I like it. I guess if I wanted to, I could give them a little wipe in case there's something else down there. But there you have it, gentlemen. So, my mistake, so you guys won't make it.
This is actually not a solid cast piece in that color. It appears to be painted that color. So, but this here is all good. Nothing going on here. It's not sticky. So that means it would also work on the lower if you have the big lower. And I'm going to keep that box lower on this one because I'm adding a bunch of electronics to this MOSFET. Might even add a relay to be sure. Do relay then to the MOSFET. But I'm going to check resistance with an ohm meter. But there you have it. So duct tape, which can be really, really hard to get off. You can use it here. So here, I would actually recommend probably maybe fingernail polish remover. That would be it. I wouldn't recommend goof off. Because you can see here it did make a mistake, and that was my bad. Good thing this is my gun, because that's the way I do it. I do everything, do all the experiments on my gun, or team guns. And this is probably the first goof up we have had here at the shop in God knows how long. So, alright, goof off takes the paint off, this piece is colored. Alright, awesome. Alright guys. See you guys on the next part of the build.